Hi, my name is Simon Howard. I'm a solutions architect at Micro Focus. So this video is all about filters and how you use them in Fortify on Demand. So what you see right in front of you is the applications view for a demo tenant that we have. And if you look really carefully, straight away you'll see there are 108 applications that this tenant knows about, many of which you see in front of you right now. And these applications have been scanned statically or dynamically and so on. As your tenant gets busier and busier with scans and applications you've created, there'll be more and more results available to you, and you need to use filters in order to drill down into them. And they're a really useful bit of functionality. On the right-hand side, here's where you actually see a list of filters in this particular view. And when you get Fortify on Demand for the first time, you get a set of filters available to you off the shelf, but you can create your own. But first, let's go and look how we might use them. So as I said, there are 108 applications on this particular tenant, and I can, you know, I could scroll through them like I'm doing right now. I can use a little, go through the various pages of applications, and you know, that might just work just fine for you. I can even use the search option up here. I enter text into the search text box and I can find my application I'm looking for. But filters are a really good way of drilling down further. So if you look carefully, you can see there are these filters here, some of which are available off the shelf to you and some you can create. So there's one here called business criticality. So if I click that, I can select that, and you'll notice in the center, in a second, use refreshed, and you can see now this little bar's appeared here, and I've got a filter applied, which is business criticality of high. I selected the high filter for that particular attribute. And now that I'm just seeing there's a list of 68 applications. And I might want to drill down a little bit further. I might want to say, for example, look at applications that are of the high business criticality and have a star rating of 1. That's how we measure how an application rates against its security policy. So now we've got 14 applications listed, and you know, you can see straight away I've now drilled down further into my information. Of course, right now what I might want to do is go and look at the results of a scan, let's say, or set of scans for a particular application. I can do that. That's outside the scope of this video. There are other videos available on how to do that on our YouTube channel, for example. Okay, so that's one way in which you can use filters. So I'm going to reset those filters. And now let's think about what I might want to do. Well, I said to you earlier, there are some available off the shelf, and you can go and create your own one. So how do you go do that? So to do that, you have to have typically a security lead role. So I'm going to go to the administration tab. I have the security lead role in this particular tenant. So I can go and create a new filter. Now, the way I do that is I go to the administration tab, as I did, and I go now down to settings. And then I basically go into this other view where I see a set of tabs, the first one of which is attributes. Now, when you use a filter, what you're actually doing is using one or more attributes. So let's imagine what I want to do in my tenant is I want to have a new attribute that is associated with marking certain applications as being legacy applications or not. And so then I'm going to filter on that. It's really easy to do that. So I'm going to create a new attribute. I'm going to call it legacy app. I could call it whatever I want, but obviously it makes sense to use something that makes sense. And then I've got a set of data types I can use. So these data types basically are the data type that's used for the attribute, if you see what I mean. So in some cases I use a pick list, and some cases text, boolean, date, and user, and so on. So in this particular case, I just want a boolean attribute. So I'll select that, and then I can optionally check this box here to say whether I want this to be an attribute that's always required when I create a new application, definition that is within Fortify on Demand, and whether it can be editable only by security leads or anyone, any user that has an account on the particular tenant. I'm going to leave both unchecked for now. Doesn't matter for the purposes of this demonstration. And here it is, it's appeared right down, it refreshed in the background. I can go and edit that further if I want to. I can delete it if I change my mind, but I'm going to leave that right now as is. I'm going to go back to where I was in the application view. And now I can apply that attribute. So I'm just going to take one application. We'll take this one here, which is the WG application. I'm going to select that. And now I'm going to change the attribute for this application. So to do that, I go here and I click Settings. And now I'm going to change the attributes that apply to this application. So I select the Application Attributes tab. And these are the ones that are available to me for this application. And I'm just going to look and find my legacy app. There it is. Now it defaults, as a Boolean, it defaults to false. But I'm going to change this to true. And I'm going to save it. What this means now is that attribute of value for the legacy app is now set to true. Kind of obvious, really, but I just thought I wanted to point that out to you. Go back to where I was in the main application view. And now, if I go here, you'll see that legacy app is appearing. And what I can do is I can see straight away, if I've expanded that, there is one application where it's set to true, and then there are 107, the 108 minus one, right, which are set to not set. So if I click that filter there, straight away I can drill down and see the legacy apps, if you like, in this use case across my application estate. Now what I could go on to do now is find all the other legacy apps in my application estate, mark them in the same way, and then I could filter on them later on in different ways, maybe combining with other filters. So you can see it's really easy to create a filter, which is actually an attribute, filter on it, and combine it with other ones. It's really easy to do. Okay, so that's how you go about creating the filter, and that's one use case in the application view. So let's clear that down. We'll stay within the application view and we'll just expand this menu here in the left hand side. Now we were actually looking at the applications, our applications if you like, but we might want to also look at our releases. So on Fortify on Demand, for any application that you have a set of releases that you release. That's obvious, right? As you in your life cycle, whether you're using Agile or another method, then you will have a set of releases you release through time of your application. So in this particular view, what we see now is a list of all the releases of all the applications across this particular tenant. I can scroll through them much in the same way I did in the other view. I can go through different pages to find them, but I can also use filters. So let's go do that. So in this particular case, there's several ways I can drill down. So right now you can see some tabs here, all development, QA test, production, and retired. And these are different filters I can use. So I can select development, will show me all my applications are in the development state in the SDLC, if you like. So that's filtered that down a little bit. And I might want to go in the right hand side over here. And I want to look at, let's say, the applications which are in the development state, if you like, but are, let's say, the C# applications. And now you can see there are four of them. So there are four applications in the development state and they are C# applications. Okay, let's clear that filter down. And now let's go to the remaining part of this view, which is scans. So for any application you have, or any release, you will have a number of scans you'll do through time according to your development process. So here, now what you're seeing for this tenant of the 108 applications, 315 scans have been performed. Again, I could filter that. Now, in this particular case, it's defaulted to not bringing up a list of all those filters. To bring it back up, and it's the same for the other views, I click that, and now I can see that filter column again. So in this case, I might want to, let's say, in a scenario, I might want to look at static scans. So that's basically where I've statically analyzed code. And then you can see now we've got 146 of scans listed. And let's expand that a bit more. And let's say I'm interested in the C# applications that have been statically scanned. And you can see now there are 10. Okay, so you can, again, you can see how you can use it. Okay, let's close that filter down. And let's go back to the application view. So far we've looked at that, the way you can filter on the application view, the release view, and scan. Now, another cool way in which you can use filters is actually when you're looking at application results. So let's go and look at our WG application again. And let's go drill into the results for, let's say, release 5 of the application. So I can click on that. That will take me initially to a view that shows me the results that have been assigned to the critical bucket, I should say. So I know, for example, there are 356 critical issues in release 5 of this application. Now, the layout of this screen is slightly beyond the scope of this presentation. There's another video on that. But I want to tell you how you can use filters. So on the right-hand side, you can see the filters that are available to me in this particular view right now. Imagine that I want to know which vulnerabilities are assigned to me. So if I expand that one here, the assigned user filter, I can see the issues that are currently on this for this particular release of this application, so release 5 of the WG application. These are the people that you know, the users, if you like, on the tenant that have issues assigned to them. So I'm Simon, and if I click on this filter here, I can then very quickly see the two applications that are assigned to me. And if I expand here, out here, I can do it by category. That's what I really want to do, so I can see them. You can see I have two privacy violations that are assigned to me. What I might want to do is I might want to say, well, what will happen if I change that, if I go and reassign an issue to me? So let me clear that, these filters down, and look at all the issues in this particular release, so you get the point. So we'll go here. We can see there are 27 SQL injections. And let me go and sign, just for the purpose of the demo, one of them to me. So I'll select backdoors.java. And currently, it's assigned to Ada Vincent. Let's pretend Ada Vincent is part of our development team. But now I am actually going to look at that myself. Or maybe Vincent asked me to do that. So I'll find myself and I'll reassign this to me. There I am there. And now it's assigned to me. Now if I go and look and assign user again, now you can see you want to add there, didn't do that. If I go here now, and now you can see it's assigned to me. And there's the SQL injection. You can do all kinds of other things. What I could do, for example, right now I filtered on that, but I could actually save this filter. So let's select save query. Let's call this issues assigned to Simon. We'll put Simon H actually, you can write more than Simon, of course. Click save. And now there is a custom query which is issues assigned to Simon. So let's prove that point. We'll clear the filters. Now we're seeing all the issues again. If I select that, and now we're seeing that filter has been applied, and we're just seeing the issues assigned to me. I can, of course, create a more complex filter. So I could, for example, say I could modify this filter, this query rather, so that I see issues that are assigned to me but are in the pending review state, for example. You can imagine what you can do. So I hope you can see that filters are really useful. It's a great way of drilling down into your information, your results. That's it for now. See you in the next video.